Today we're going to take a deep dive into this, the start of our workplace EV charging series. It's the Chargestorm Connect 2 from C-TEK. I'm going to put this down on the bench, Gary, because it's a substantial, well-built unit, but that also means it's quite heavy. Now, we haven't looked at a lot of commercial EV chargers on the channel before, and you don't see many on social media either, so we thought it'd be good to take a look inside and explore the key components, how it works, and then later on in this video we'll show you actually how easy it is to commission and set up this charger, which is always something we worry about, especially when there's an app and an internet connection required.
You said substantial, I'd say also beautiful. For those EV chargers that we've seen dotted around, a three-phase one looking this pretty is a rarity, and it's got a beautiful LED display as well that's clearly visible, whether it be charging or in a fault mode, isn't it?
Yeah, you're right, because a lot of these, yeah, those look like either, post boxes or utility cupboards, and a little bit agricultural, as you say, but this gorgeous Swedish design, yeah, great for what we've used it for in our installation here, obviously workplace EV charging, but I can see this fitting in some other application where you may want to charge people to charge.
Okay.
So we're thinking sort of multi-story car parks or tourist venues or hotels, and yeah, this is what this is set up to do, because it will communicate with other apps as part of the open charge point protocol. We're not going to go that deep into it today. We're going to explore it for, say, workplace applications. So I guess we should have a little look inside.
Yeah, you've stalled long enough now. The key at the top will open it up, and I love this because it's not always an electrician going in. Sometimes it's an unskilled person that might be going in maybe to reset a breaker that has tripped, or going in there to read the meter. So, of course, by opening that key and folding it down, when we put it back, we ain't got any issues with that IP rating. And we've known in the past, haven't we, having to do screws at certain torque settings when you've gone into them. And it's IP54, and the last thing we want to do is get moisture in there.
Yeah, and so it is built with that in mind. Yeah, you've got sort of essentially two enclosures in one. You've got one that's accessible by, shall we say, the non-skilled electrical person, because there's some, and think about your install, it might be the electrician who does the fixed wiring and cabling, then somebody else who comes along to plug in and do the clean coat bit with the commissioning and the laptop and look technical, and that's how this charger works. So what we're going to do is just drop this front down. It's got these two steel retraining straps, a little bit like the back shelf, the partial shelf of your car. So you wouldn't normally need to do this, but we're just doing
let's fold that down.
You can see it on the bench.
I'll bring in the hand cam.
So it is, yeah, charger two halves. So this is the brains of the charger and where you make your data connections, and we'll come back to that later. So let's first leap into the bit that electricians like to see, the connections and the working parts. I've already removed the screws in this inner cover. So obviously with that in place, you can't access any of the electrical terminals. Let me just bring this out.
Okay, wiggle that one out of the way. And there we see a lot of components. And I think as we go through this, you'll see what quality those components are as well. But it's like a two halves, isn't it? It's of the same things, isn't it?
Yeah, so at first it looks quite busy, but really it is quite simple. The two halves are mirrored because this is a dual charger. So it's got two 22 kilowatt AC charge connection outputs, a few additional components that we'll go into that you don't normally see in a residential style of charger. But let's start at the bit most people like to see, and that's the mains connection. So we've got some quality Wago top job DIN rail terminal inputs there for our phase connections, neutral and the protective conductor. So again, the screwless, you just put the operating tool in there to open the cage clamp and put in the ferrule cables that we used in this installation. So you haven't got to worry about any torque settings there. So that's one potential issue removed.
And where would the cable be coming in for that connection?
So it's generally recommended for a three-phase connection to bring in this entry that's at the bottom of the unit. Well, there is one at the back of the unit that you drill out. We decided in our install to come in through the lower entry here. You can, and the good thing about this is put these chargers back to back on a post, and C-TEK make a special box to allow you to do that, which makes an easy connection. But these connections, you'll take up the 16mm². That's exactly what we've used in our installation.
Is there any other way I can come into the enclosure, say if I was using it in a different way, maybe single phase?
Yeah, so there is some pre-drilled cable entries at the top, one for power and another one for data there. that you may use if you're, say, wall mounting this enclosure, as you say, with a single phase. There are lots of different versions in this ChargeStorm series. We've got the untethered unit here because that's what we tend to recommend for workplace chargers, so you're not worrying about maintaining the lead as part of the charger. And then the other components, as I say, it's a mirror image down through the charger, apart from a little power supply to run the internal electronics. We've got our Type 2 connectors here that people will be very familiar with because they're on, obviously, most cars and the majority of chargers.
Of course, this one being three phase, isn't it? 22 kilowatts?
Yep, it certainly is. And then inside, so next to the socket, you've got the locking solenoid that locks the cable in place when charging is taking place, but we'll also show you later how to permanently lock the cable in place if you wanted to sort of leave it as a sort of tethered type unit. Up from there, here's the charge point controller. So this obviously looks at that communication between the car and the charger to decide how much power is going flowing between them and the correct type of cables plugged in. This also runs the RCD function. Now, if you look down here, we can see the current transformer that's used for the RCD function. So that's all built into this unit, so you don't need an additional RCD upstream from the unit. But it's all done electronically, and obviously using the contactor function that we see here as well. So we're used to seeing these in chargers. So this kicks in, obviously, when charging starts, and then obviously isolates the charger when the cable is removed. So moving on up, we'll see, here's our meter. So if you're going to use a charger for actually charging people in terms of extracting money off them to charge the car, that needs to be an MID class meter. That we've explored before on the channel, and there's one on either side. But obviously that communicates back through the electronics at the bottom there, so that you don't necessarily have to always go in and read that meter. You can do that remotely and again plug into a charging management system. And then we've got independent circuit breakers for each side of the charger. Type C32 here, so again each side has its own protection. And then at the top there, you'll see a bus bar connecting them. But again, this reeks of high quality build because there's a lot of brand names in here. People recognize we've got the Wago terminals, we've got the ABB switch gear and bus bar. So that's it. So it's a compact unit. There's quite a bit going on in there. Before we leave this, let's have a look at the mounting points. So if we just look in there's four mounting positions that you can see through the back of the unit there. So there's two at the top. And then there's another two midway through the unit, just behind the solenoid at each side.
When we come back down to the front cover, just talk me through the connections that we've got down here.
Okay, so we'd route our data connection to connect to the Ethernet to this RJ45 port here. And then we've also got a mini USB connection here that we'll use for some initial commissioning. Just to show how easy it is to access for commissioning the charger. So again, the key in the top and then the front hinges down. So the charger is powered up, but I'm not going to be able to access the electrical terms because I've got an internal shield. I'm just going to plug into the mini USB port at one end and then directly into a laptop at the other. And then just put in the IP address and the default password. And then we're into the internal settings of the charger. You can see two green status LEDs there in the left-hand corner of our outlets, so we can already see that. Settings, you can do quite a bit in here, from setting the light intensity to specifics to do with the actual outlets. Now, each outlet works independently, as we've said, and can be commissioned as to use an RFID tag to start charging or left in open, so basically anyone can just plug in and start charging. And you can manage that through here, but also through the app that we'll come on to a little bit later. Possibly the main thing that electricians probably need to do is configure the circuit arrangements that are feeding the charger itself. So we're okay here because we've got a 63 amp circuit breaker upstream from this, so we can use this at maximum charge capability. You can dive into lots of different things, even some diagnostics to do an electronic test of the RCD function. So again, just there's that and some other diagnostics in here. But again, it's packed full of features.
So in order to complete the commissioning process, Gordon, I didn't see any use of an internet cable. It was just the laptop linked to the charger, is that right?
Yeah, so you can do most of the major functions through just using a laptop, and that's great for installations where there's no Internet connection. If there is no internet connection, actually, you can also get an option to put a 3G SIM card in there as well. So that might be good for remote car park applications and the like.
Yeah, so let's get on to it. It's almost the elephant in the room when you talk to Gaz. It's the app, and there is an app for it, isn't there?
There is an app, and it's incredibly easy to set up. After downloading the Taking Charge app, it's really easy to add a charger to it. You just look on the back of the charger near the Ethernet port, you'll find the app ID and put that in. But we may want to also give it a friendly name so we can remember which charge point we're at, particularly if there's a lot of them in a car park next to each other. But we're going to call our one eFIXX HQ. So we're doing that, and that is our charger added to the app. Easy. So let's just see how the charger and the app work together. So we're just going to see that we can reflect what's happening in the charger in the app itself. So I've plugged in a car to charge. We're watching for the blue battery symbol to flash to say that charging's commenced, and we can now see that in the app. So here's how to remotely lock a cable in place using the CTEK Charge app. So just open the app, select the output where the cable is inserted into, and then just switch that little indicator across, and that's our charge cable locked in place. Also, while we're in this screen, you can see it's actually even possible to dim the lights on the front of the charger itself. You may want to do this in an area that's sensitive, so a forest or something like that, where you don't want to create too much distraction or light. So possibly the most common application for this Taking Charge app is going to be putting an RFID tag in to enable access to charging. That is, again, really simple. So give your user a name, it's me in this case, and then you'll find there's a number on the back of the RFID tag. Just put that into the app and then add, and that is the process done. Again, a little update. Then we've enabled RFID charging, so now plug the car in when I want to start a charging session. So we'll see also that the little wireless symbol there at the bottom is illuminated green to show that it's now enabled as an RFID charge point. It is possible to have each side different, so one open and one RFID tagged. So now come along with our tag. There's a quick amber light on the RFID symbol, and then our charging session has started.
However much I want to give you technical prowess for using that app, it was an incredibly simple process to watch you do, wasn't it, Gordon?
Yeah, it was. This whole install and setup procedure has been pretty much seamless. There was only one problem, Gary.
Okay, what was the problem?
That was on my side. I hadn't plugged in the Ethernet cable at the other end into the patch box in our networking enclosure, so that's why I couldn't get the app to work initially. Apart from that, smooth as anything. Instructions are great, really well laid out. Just step through them and yeah, job done.
So again, if you're a little bit nervous about maybe stepping up from single phase to three phase installations of EV chargers, I would suggest this C-TEK one would be where I'd be going, because based on this video and the feedback we've given you, we think it's an incredibly easy, simple process in order to install, isn't it, Gordon?
It is, and we've also made a video where we step you through the entire installation process we went through for this charger. So not necessarily about the charger itself, about the other tricky bits, the actual mounting the charger to the car park, all the way through the cable ducting back to the other end of the electrical installation, and some of the things you might need to consider there, because often the barrier to EV charger isn't the actual charging itself, it's actually the existing installation, how much power is available in the building.
And we'll leave that playlist. It'll either be in the card at the very end. It will definitely be in the link in the description. But as always, we want your feedback. Are you currently fitting single phase and three phase EV chargers? And you want to leave us some feedback? Is it a market you're going to get into and you think this playlist will be very helpful for you? Please do all those comments below. We'll try and get back to as many as we can.